only 17 new cases recorded in Victoria today, but with
more than 250 exposure sites that are connected to this outbreak.
The Premier has flagged that the lockdown, scheduled to end at midnight tomorrow, will not.
If we had been open, then we would be just like Sydney. We would have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of cases.
New South Wales has now seen over 1,300 cases since the Bondi outbreak. Today, reporting
98 cases of community transmission.
With up to 44 of those cases out in the community, the state's lockdown has no end in sight. But it's these numbers that really underscore the seriousness of the Delta strain.
There are currently 82 COVID cases admitted to hospital, with 24 in intensive care.
The state also recording its fifth death from the COVID outbreak, a Sydney woman in her 50s, reported to be the mother of the removalists who travelled into Western New South Wales while infected. In South Australia, a new case of community transmission has seen the state bringing in level 4 restrictions beginning at midnight.
We can see what happens in other jurisdictions around the world where there are delays in putting restrictions in place. We don't want that in South Australia.
Despite the different situations across the country, the Premiers do have one thing in common today. A new study shows that 42% rate their state and territory as doing a better job of handling the pandemic than the federal government.
We're all in this together.
Well, The Guardian's chief political correspondent Sarah Martin joins us now to discuss that point. Sarah, why do you think it is that state leaders are proving more popular than the federal ones?
Well, I don't think we need to look too hard to find the answer to that. I mean, obviously, the state governments have been very proactive with lockdowns. We know that those border closures have been quite popular, and this polling from the Australia Institute today shows that very clearly. And we know that all the criticism at the moment is directed at the federal government for the vaccine program. So that is the reason I would say that over the course of this pandemic, since the Australia Institute started tracking people's views of both levels of government, that's why that has shifted. I mean, you've got to remember last year, it was all about that, you know, there was no vaccine. It was all about keeping the virus out of the country. And obviously the federal government took quite a leading role in that in terms of shutting the borders and so forth. But since then, the dynamic has shifted and now it's about the vaccine rollout. We've moved along the curve somewhat and now the criticism is clearly directed at the federal government. And at the same time, the states are still doing as best they can to keep people safe by shutting state borders and going into lockdown.
Is it possible, Sarah, there's a parochial element to this?
Do you think?
I wonder generally, you know, as borders go up and movements restricted, do you begin to feel more New South Welsh than Australian than Australian?
Absolutely. I think this has been a really interesting thing that's happened over the course of this pandemic. We've all become statriots, you know, and I think that's been particularly true with what you've seen over in WA, where Mark McGowan is he's almost like the king of WA and, you know, the state's about to secede as far as I can tell. So, I think it has brought out that element of people and they are looking to their state leaders to protect their little kingdoms. And I think absolutely that has really shone through in this pandemic. And I think because, you know, we have seen the success of those states by taking that sort of state-first approach, by saying, no, we are going to close our borders, we are going to try and keep our New South Welshmen, our South Australians, our West Australians safe. And overwhelmingly, that has been successful. So, yes, absolutely, I think it's very much been a state-first, a sort of team state rather than team Australia at the moment.
Sarah, News Poll now has Labor jumping 6 points ahead of the coalition in two-party preferred. Is the next election less certain than we've been led to believe?
Oh, look, I always think that the elections are always pretty uncertain. And I think particularly the results we're seeing at the moment are very clearly reflect a snapshot of feeling on the ground at the moment. And we know that the federal government's under particular criticism because of the vaccine rollout. It's really a very clear position for Labor, which we haven't seen since the election, very clearly ahead. And if the results today were repeated on election day, then that would give them a very clear victory. However, the election's not been held today. The election is most likely to be in March next year, and certainly the federal government is very unlikely to go until some of this vaccine rollout has been fixed up. So it's very difficult to predict the next election. If we are in a position in the new year where the bulk of the population is vaccinated and there is signs of returning to normal, then you know, maybe people aren't going to be feeling quite so angry about this, but it really depends on how the next 6 to 9 months go and whether or not people are going to still be hostile towards the Morrison government for its handling of this.
The federal government copped a lot of criticism for offering financial assistance to New South Wales more readily than for Victoria. Do you think that had an impact?
In terms of the financial assistance, look, obviously there was a lot of political pressure on the government, particularly after they had held out on the Victorians in the most recent lockdown, that they really couldn't afford to cop that political heat again for New South Wales. And then with Victoria going back into lockdown, there was none of the sort of game playing that went on last time when, of course, you had Morrison talking about perverse incentives for the states for lockdown. I think that... even, you know, there was a slight quibble over whether the feds would stump up the cash for the lockdown, given initially it was only going to be 5 days rather than 7 days. You didn't see the Commonwealth wanting to pick that fight with Dan Andrews a second time. So I think the politics of that has shifted. And I think given the federal government's need for these lockdowns to work, they're going to be making sure that there are no financial disincentives now for the states to make those decisions.
Sarah, thanks so much for your time.
Thanks, guys.
Do you know what I find politically really interesting is as the lockdowns have shifted from being a Melbourne thing to now a Sydney thing, I reckon the politics changes completely. So I think for Morrison, when Melbourne's in lockdown, you can kind of say what you want because no one in Melbourne's voting for you.
Yeah.
but in Sydney, it's a very big, important political area. And I'd just be fascinated to see at the next election what effect that has in the end. Yeah.
Not too long to wait.
Well, who knows? Who knows? All right, after a break, we'll see you soon.
With so much content online, it's sometimes hard to keep up with it all. And let's face it, who has the time? The project YouTube has you covered with the stories that matter. Hit subscribe for a daily list of the news that you need to know.